Good morning and welcome to The Big Scope, India's first post-cable network here in India. And on the show today, I've got me two very special gentlemen with me. I've got me Venu Kota and R Chandrashekar. So first up, there's so much talk about, you know, the digital economy in India. Now, what needs to be changed to make it more regional specific for jobs in India?
Well, you know, the digital economy is driven by talent, but its impact is felt everywhere. So the two questions that come for the look that arise when you talk about the location of the digital industry is the availability of the talent, and that in turn depends on a conducive ecosystem in terms of the availability of a critical mass of talent, availability of technical institutions, availability of corporates and jobs in that particular area, availability of good infrastructure, which is important for the younger generation especially, including social infrastructure as well as civic infrastructure, transportation and so on. So all of these are coming together are an extremely important driver of where the industry goes. However, given its very nature of the medium, the impact of this is being felt all across the country.
So just to add on to that, Venu sir, I mean, how do you how important do you think is vernacular content in terms of jobs in India? So in terms of jobs, in terms of startups, how important is going to be vernacular content, the sector for vernacular content?
So from a language perspective, I don't see a big impact, because if you see most of the jobs that we are inheriting into India are from the countries like US and all, right? But I see definitely there is an impact on some of the segments like BPOs and all, because where there is an influence of your language skills and all of that. So from an Nasscom standpoint, there are some studies and.
Yeah, I'm not from a Nasscom point, but I, based on my earlier association, I can say that, you know, the BPO industry is again of two types. So one is that which is focused on the external markets, which is largely English, where the language is involved, which again tends to follow the same paradigm which I talked about. The second is the BPO industry for the domestic market, which is critically dependent on vernacular also, Hindi in particular, which is useful for a large part of the country, and local language in other parts of the country as well. And that certainly is very tightly coupled to the availability of language skills, and therefore highly localized. And some of the initiatives of the government, like setting up rural BPM centers, rural BPO centers, are important initiatives to actually tap into that opportunity in those areas. So, but the in terms of size, it's the global market which is still much larger, and the domestic market is only now picking up, but that will certainly provide employment opportunities to a large number of people, and especially very young people.
So to that point, a question to both of you. You've seen recently, I mean, in terms of the anti-immigrant you know, debate that Trump is having, and also recently, a couple of days ago, what UK said in terms of not putting India under the relaxed visa policies. How much will it impact students coming from our country, going to countries like Ireland, UK, US? Do you see that as an impact, or is it just a political gimmick on the higher grounds?
Well, you know, the impact of these policies, first and foremost, let us remember that every country, the policy making is determined by what they think is in their own country's interest. So Indian skilled people going to US, going to UK, is not only because of their need, it is in large part because of the need of those countries as well. The second is, if you look at students also, students who are going into these institutions in those countries are not going there displacing a local student. They are going there and filling seats which would otherwise go a begging. And a lot of universities in the US, for example, their whole economic model depends on foreign students coming in, and if these students are prevented from going in, the first casualty would be those universities and institutions themselves. So the point I'm making is that there is a natural limit to how far these policies can go. Political rhetoric and positioning is one thing, but actual implementation and the extent to which these can be taken is very different story.
So moving forward, I mean, I'll ask you something. I mean, you know, can joint ventures help Indian real estate companies navigate complexities and create value?
Yes, I feel. Because of the fact that India has a lot of natural talent pool. You have a lot of investments possible. And we have strong process experts in India. But sometimes what happens is that you don't have the right funding. So that's where I feel if you have the joint ventures, right, they'll be able to actually amalgamate as a single corporation and develop more.
So to add to that, it's a question to both of you. Then, do you think India's subprime mortgage mania can quickly turn into panic, or is it just hyperbole?
Well, you know, I think that we are in a very different situation here. First and foremost, I don't think we have quite had the bubble that existed in some other countries. And arguably, these are only the normal cycles that are traditional in the real estate business, nothing more than that. So I would certainly not see any panic, any need for a panic, or for that matter, any evidence of a panic at this point. But I don't know, you may have a view.
Couple of last things. I mean, you've seen the way the kind of startup organizations which have sprung up in the last 3 or 4 years. I really want to understand, but what about hardware product startups in India? Where do you see them growing? How can the industry and how can industry bodies come together to help them? Because more or less, it's all that we have seen is about software startups, application startups. IoT startups are there, but how do you, you know, help hardware startups in India? How do you create that ecosystem?
See, the first and foremost, I think that we have to look at the question of the competitive advantage of a country. In the hardware segment, India's competitive advantage is very small, or maybe even negative, because of several reasons. You know, if you compare it with China, there is actually a big difference in terms of the economics of operation. And therefore, many of the manufacturing activities are not even viable in India in the absence of government support. And government cannot subsidize industry. Interest rates are high, cost of power is high, cost of logistics are higher, uncertainties in the logistics chain are higher. And we are talking about an electronics industry which lives by, you know, quarter day, half day inventories. In a country like India, anybody would be mad to have an inventory which is less than 10 days given the kind of uncertainty that exists. But that translates into a cost in business. So the point I'm making is that for a hardware industry, the economics are somewhat uphill. However, the big opportunity there is that we must play to our strengths. Leverage our capability in design, leverage our capability in which is in terms of the design and prototype manufacturing, which is a strong capability in India. We are doing it for the world industry. And the good news is that in electronics, the biggest value addition today is coming from the embedded software and the design. And therefore, by focusing on that segment and leveraging that, then we will actually be able to get our teeth into the hardware industry. We should not worry about whether it is manufacturing in terms of having huge assembly lines, or whether it is manufacturing in terms of design, which to the uninitiated, you may go and say, where is the manufacturing? There is no manufacturing. But the fact is that that's a much, much bigger part of it.
So you're okay to say that we can still do good and remain as, you know, design in India, manufacture in China and sell it across the world?
I think there is a huge disadvantage to that, which we have to recognize, which is that the lower skilled employment intensive jobs, where will they come from? Because in the design, the jobs are relatively high skilled and not necessarily as large in numbers as in the case of an assembly line. So we do need to worry about that implication, not from an economic standpoint, but from an employment standpoint.
And one last thing, to you specifically in general, how do you solve the issue of inventory pileup in the real estate sector today in India?
So I think what is...
But is this something, I mean, am I speaking out of the way? Is it a hyperbole? Is this something an issue still?
This question relates back to the first question you asked, Mr. Chandrashekar, right? Inventory is directly related to not just only the company's setup, right? It related to infrastructure, talent, and all of those. So it's an industry-wide solution that somebody needs to work upon, right? That you have to promote the right talent, right infrastructure, social infrastructure. Then you will be able to address the inventory issue. Because today, if you recall the slides that Mr. Chandrashekar has shown, right, top three markets are NCR, Bangalore, and Mumbai. And if you see the number of jobs that are getting created are Mumbai, and if you see Karnataka is, you know, somewhere in the second or third or fourth in the bullet, right? So if we have to bridge that gap, we need to ensure that all those parameters are addressed jointly. That's my...
Absolutely. Do you have any parting comments on that?
No, I think that, you know, in the case of the corporate real estate demand, and the jobs, they are not very tightly coupled, because corporate real estate demand is largely related to higher skilled jobs, and industry like the IT sector, banking, financial sector, and insurance, and so on. Whereas the lesser skilled jobs may be very good from an employment perspective. I gave the example of the hardware manufacturing, but they don't necessarily translate into demand. So it's not you can't sort of just translate one into the other directly. And the slight mismatch between where the jobs are getting created and where the real estate demand is there is because more of those kind of jobs are getting created in a place like Bangalore, and therefore the real estate demand is high here.
Lovely. So folks, that was R. Chandrashekar and Venu Kota talking to us about the future of jobs, digital economy, and issues faced with the real estate sector in India. And this is Aritra signing out for The Big Scope.